In this video, we explore simple string and while loop. We also get a bit fancy by drawing text border around the string. What's up everyone? Welcome to Programmer Life. You can find the video timestamp and a link to source code used in the video down in the description below. Let's get started. In the previous video, we created our first program to print Hello World on screen. I have a link to the video on the top right for quick reference. Now, what if we want to say hello to a friend, not to the whole world? We can change the hello world to say, hello Bill, and this works. However, to say hello to another friend, say Sarah, we need to change the program again, build and run. We can improve it by giving the name to the program at runtime. The IOStream header has another object, cin, and this allows us to take input from the keyboard. We need to store this input somewhere so we can later use it in Cout. We can store input data in memory. C++ allows us to store data in memory through what is known as variable. Variable gives memory a name, so we can easily access it in our program. C++ expects two pieces of information from us for a variable, its name and what type of data it stores. We can briefly go over some primary C++ data types. Int is used to store integers or whole numbers, positive, negative, and zero, like minus 9, 10. Float stores floating point numbers, like 3.2, minus 2.4. Char stores a single character. Characters are represented with single quotes around them, like A, X. Bool can store only two values, either true or false. C++ doesn't have a string as a primary data type. However, C++ allows users to create their own data types, combining primary data types. The standard library has a user-defined type, string. String contains a collection of primary data type, character. We can use it in our program by including the header, string. We want to store a name, which is a string type. Let's name it friend name. We should separate words in a variable name so we can easily read it. I like to start first letter lowercase, then each new word with a capital letter. This naming convention is called camel case. Well, the uppercase letter does make it look like a camel hump. Separating words with an underscore is another popular naming convention. You can use any naming convention. Staying consistent improves code readability. Now that we have a place to store data, the cin statement can store the data in the string, and we use the input operator to direct input from cin object to the string. One small detail here is that when we created the variable, it is an empty string. Then we use the same variable to store user input. So we can see the value of the variable changed, and it's not fixed. Thus a variable signifies its value can vary. We can modify the cout statement to output string now. Also, having a prompt to ask for the name would be a nice touch. If we run the program now, we are prompted to input our friend's name. Once we enter the name, program prints the welcome message. We have seen how to input and output string in a program. We can modify our program to put a decorative frame around our friend's name. We use the simple frame for the name. To frame the name, we can put some cout around the welcome message. Let's test it out. We can input Daniel. Looks good. Let's try again with another name, Josephine. Didn't turn out to be quite right. So, we need a way to know the length of our message so that we can print the correct number of asterisks. To calculate length, we need to store complete hello message in another string. Let's create a variable to store hello string. Since this is not necessarily a variable, we know it has a hello string and it won't change. C++ has a keyword const to signify it's a constant. If we prefix any variable with a const keyword, its value cannot change. We prefix hello string to the name string. C++ allows giving operators a different meaning for user-defined data types, also called overloading. Plus operator is overloaded for string data type. Unlike integers, it appends the second string to the first and returns the result. Also, we can define functions specific to user-defined data types. These are called member functions. We use dot operator with the variable to call a member function for user-defined type. One of the string's member functions is length, and it returns the string's size. You can see as I type dot, IDE gives me many other functions. These are all member functions of the string data type. We use length function here. One other neat C++ feature is auto keyword. We can use it to specify the data type. C++ already knows we are storing a string in this variable. So if we use auto data type here, C++ considers this variable as a string. Auto is convenient when using user defined data types, whose names can be longer. Also, it is considered an excellent habit of initializing a variable when declaring it, and auto enforces it since we cannot have an uninitialized auto variable. Trying to declare an uninitialized auto variable throws a compilation error, since C++ cannot determine the exact type. Moving forward, we can create two strings, one for the line with all hashes and another with hash and asterisk. When we create a string, we can also create it with repeated characters. If we give first how many times to repeat and second what character to repeat, the string has those many repeated same characters. We can use this knowledge to create repeated asterisk string and hash string. Asterisk string contains as many asterisks as welcome message length. Hash string contains message length plus 4 more hash on each side, so 8 more hashes. We also need to add 4 more hashes on each side of the asterisk string. We can use plus operator for that. Now, let's replace string literals with these newly created strings. We are ready to test out our program with multiple names and see how it goes. I'm gonna run this program from outside the IDE since it's easier to do multiple consecutive runs from outside. Let's try Bill. Looks good. Sarah. This works as well. Let's try Christopher. The frame looks good. Our code is generalized to work with any name. Before we move forward, this is an excellent time to smash that like button. It helps with the YouTube algorithm and reaches more people. Since we have created an excellent welcome frame, the next obvious thing is to print it out on a postcard and send it to our friends. You know what? You can create your postcard frame just the way we did one here. Leave your postcard down in the comment below. I would love to see your creation. Now, if you were to send the postcard to 10 of your friends, you would need to run this program, enter first name, print out the label, run again, enter second friend name, rinse and repeat. Now, one thing that computers are very good at is repeating tasks. It would be a shame if we were to do it. C++ allows us to loop or repeat a block as many times as we want. A block is a group of statements closed in a curly braces. We have already seen a block with the function names. C++ has two types of loops. While loop, as the name suggests, repeats something while some condition holds. The second type is the for loop. We usually use this loop as a counting loop. For instance, repeat the instructions from 0 to 10, or repeat for all characters in the string. In our case, we use while loop. Our condition would be to print names in the frame while any more names are left. Let's first comment out the existing code. It's a good idea to write new code by breaking in smaller pieces, validating each piece to be working as intended and integrating it into the existing solution. Here we can visualize the problem as a three-part problem. First, input all names. Second, repeat for all names. And third, draw a frame for each of them. We have already verified the third piece of the program. For the first part, we input names and output them to see if we got the correct input. Okay, we run to see if we get the correct input. The string only got the first name. When we give input to the program through cin, it considers enter or space as the end of user input. That's why the string only got one name. The standard library gives us another function to accept strings with spaces. This function is called getline. It utilizes the same cin to accept input but accepts spaces as well. We can try again and see if we can accept a string with spaces now. Perfect. We have solved the first part of the problem. Now, we can proceed to the second part and see if we can loop through each name. We have just seen that regular cin considers one input complete at a space. We have a solution to the second problem if we can input this string to cin and cin gives us each string one by one stopping at a space. Well, C++ gives us another type of stream. This stream takes data from a string instead of a keyboard and so rightly named as stringstream. The stringstream deals with strings. It is in the header file sstream. First, we create a string stream and feed in the names. Now this stream has names. We can get one by one. Like function, loop also encloses a set of instructions inside braces that it should repeat. It takes condition inside the parentheses. The string stream has a convenient function called good, which tells if the stream has data left. So, we loop while there are names left in the stream. We can create another string variable to hold one name at a time. Like cin, we can use the string stream operator to read the next frame. To validate the second step, we print each name on a new line. Great, our second step works. Now we can bring in the third step and print our postcard labels. Let's try with few names. You can see all of the names are printed with the labels. I hope our friends like these postcards. For more programming videos, hit the subscribe button. Leave a comment if you want me to cover any specific topic, and share with your friends. Thanks for watching.